I'm really happy to have our next speaker. Our keynote speaker is JPR, J. Paul Robinson from Purdue University, who has flown in today just for this meeting. So I'm sure he's no stranger to you. Paul is very well known in the cytometry world for being a past president of ISAC, being on the current protocols board, and also the Purdue cytometry list, which he's mentioned there. Is everybody here on the cytometry list? Anybody not on the cytometry list? One person. That's really impressive, Paul. So we've got 5,000 people worldwide. And it's just an amazing resource, even to just search it, because somebody will have asked the question. But I'm preaching to the converted if everybody's already on the Purdue list. So, Paul today is going to talk to us about Spectral, but it's also, get your bingo cards out, everybody, important to know that Paul has climbed Everest. There we go. It's on the bingo card. But today I don't know if you're mentioning your Everest climb, but today you're going to talk to us about how spectral cytometry started in your lab in Purdue. So we have the founding father of spectral cytometry with us today. So over to you, Paul. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rachel. Yeah, there are people who are idiotic enough to climb Mount Everest. I don't recommend it. I wondered why it's taken so long for somebody to take the initiative and have a symposium on spectral. When Rachel emailed me a few months ago with this idea that she was going to do it, I was very supportive of it. And I'm very pleased and thank you for the invitation. And I want to acknowledge that Thermo Fisher sponsored my trip over here, and I wish to acknowledge that. I suppose I'm going to talk a little bit about some historical aspects of spectral. And I'm going to speculate on a lot of things. I suppose we could call it spectralation, but that is really stretching it a little bit, I think. And I might be giving you some information you don't know, but I do think that spectral is here to stay. And so I'm going to talk about what I think the future is, but I'm going to first talk about what it's about today. Now, there are a lot of flow cytometry. It's been around for a long time. And here is the NIH publication in flow, 250,000 papers in the last 40-odd years. And what is interesting, if you look at the last few years, is quite a steep progression of papers. And that tells me that this technology is not only of interest to a lot of people, but it's starting to invade other areas of science. And I'm going to come back to that issue in a little while, when I probably will be scolding some of us for holding on to the way we do things too much for too long. But there are questions about spectral. So I'm going to, since today is a day of quizzes, I have some quizzes. And on this quiz, I already have the answers there for you, so you shouldn't get any of them wrong, and you don't get any skittles. But is polychromatic and spectral cytometry the same? No, it's not. Why did it take so long to get to spectral cytometry? That's a great question. I don't have an answer. Is there any active patterns on spectral? Yes. Is there a fundamental difference between compensation and spectral unmixing? No. Is there a difference between spectral cytometry and full spectral cytometry? No. Will all companies eventually be doing spectral? I think so. And will it be eventually in clinical labs? I hope so, because I think it's one of those things that's very necessary. So, Rachel implied that we had something to do with the invention of spectral, but who knows? So I have a quiz here. Who invented it? A, B, C, D, E, F, G, or H? None of the above. Who got 10 points? Oh, not very good group here, Rachel. Okay, when? 1066? Stuff happened then. 1965, 2004, 213 May, important date. 217 June 12, another important date. None of the above. Answer? 2004. Seems a long time ago, doesn't it? So, why were we interested in spectral? And I'll tell you why. I happened to be at the university where a professor, David Landgrebe, developed what's today known as remote sensing. You may not know this, but in 1972, military were going to send up a satellite to scan the Earth. They were looking for stuff, mostly on the Northern Hemisphere, in one particular area of the Northern Hemisphere. And so they built a system called a return beam videocon. And David Landgrebe basically said to them, I don't think that's going to work so well. And why did he say that? I'll tell you why, because he came from Indiana. We have a lot of corn in Indiana. You see down the bottom there, David Landgrebe thought, well, if I fly an airplane over corn and I spectrally analyze it, I can tell whether or not the corn is diseased or not, and then we can mitigate that. And this could be really important because Indiana's a big corn producing state. So he worked with quite a few people to do this. Finally, when what became known as Landsat 1 went up, they put two systems in. They put the RBV and they put the MSS, the multispectral scanner. And guess which one actually worked? The backup. And that is the beginning of spectral analysis, period. And you see here some, that's the first satellite. 1972, and it was renamed as Landsat 1. It wasn't originally called Landsat 1, but all the Landsats, satellites, to this day, have this spectral technology in them. So that was in my university across the campus, so I was familiar with this, and that is how I got involved in looking at spectral. And why would we do things one way when there may be another? So we spent a few years working on this, and we actually published a paper back in 2004. It wasn't easy to publish a fast paper. It took a year or more. So we went to a monthly journal, and we published this paper in a monthly journal. And we also filed a patent called Multispectral Detector and Analysis System. Now, in that paper, here is what we said in 2004. So we were interested in solving two issues, broadening the spectral photon detection environment and working out how to do spectral unmixing, because that seemed to be the critical things. And the idea was to enable our instruments to collect significantly broader bands of light. And in theory, that should be technically more simple than the technology we were familiar with in flow. Now, there is one fundamental difference that we tried to implement, and that is changing the paradigm that flow cytometry lived to die for, which is increasing intensity of a signal. Now, you still have to have good intensity of signals, but you don't have to die for it when you move to spectral. This, I think, was the most difficult concept to get across to flow cytometrists. because we constantly told ourselves the only goal in life is to make the signal more intense. And because of that, I think we couldn't see the forest for the trees or the trees for the forest. So this is the first instrument that we built. It was built on an Epix Elite cell sorter, which is on the left there. It doesn't look much like one in this photo. It used a Hamamatsu 32-channel PMT. The first version we built, we got really interesting spectral signals. We had absolutely no idea what they meant. And we rebuilt the system by putting a 6 PMT regular flow cytometer set of detectors in it, and we put regular samples in that we knew what the results were so that we could actually interpret what was happening when we were doing spectral unmixing. And we designed and built a 64-channel ADC, which is very difficult to do in those days. Well, that was in 2004. We presented this at the ISAC meeting in 2004, and the week before that meeting, we filed a patent application. And I think I gave 30, maybe 40 talks on spectral. I got invited everywhere. Please tell us about spectral flow cytometry. Well, I did, and these are some of those talks. But nobody did anything. Nobody decided that this was technology that was of interest. And you know, when you put your heart and soul into something and it doesn't work out, it's a little bit disappointing. But in that ISAC, another ISAC talk in 2006, I pointed out that you could significantly reduce the complexity of the hardware. I pointed out that when you have the spectrum, now you can apply advanced algorithms. You really have some powerful ways of analyzing the data. And that you could now build these databases that would allow you to move from this univariate, bivariate approach to a multivariate approach. And I felt at that time that this was the be-all and end-all for what I called next-generation approaches to flow cytometry. And here's a slide that's unchanged from 2004. 3 and 4. And this is how we explained it, because folks in flow cytometry were so embedded with one color, one detector, one channel being a pan pass filter and one detector, that we had to try our best to explain that this wasn't the only way to do flow cytometry. So here we have a typical three-color sample, and what we pointed out was, well, if you take the whole spectrum, it becomes a cell fingerprint, or what we call a spectral signature. Once you have that concept in your mind, you should be able to now analyze pretty much anything in a flow cytometry. And we compared what we called multicolor or polychromatic versus what we called multispectral at the time. Now, we've changed that from multi to just spectral. But the idea was, use the spectrum as a parameter, which it never was, because we take a little bit of information, we throw away information, which is not a good thing, and then we try to do our, traditional analysis. So here's the first experiment that we did with beads. We bought beads that had dye in them, chlorophyll, rhodamine, PE, and we ran them through our regular system. And when you do that, you end up with something that is quite difficult to extract because these dyes so heavily overlap. But what we found was, in those days, even using simple approach like principal component analysis, which with only three parameters is easy to do, we could completely separate those running through our flow cytometer without any gating at all. And we said, oh, wow, okay, if you can do that, maybe you can do this with lymphocytes. And so we took lymphocytes, human lymphocytes, and we labeled them, and we mixed them, and we ran them. And guess what? We ended up with a way of discriminating with those. And we even wrote some software that allowed us to unmix those samples. And we thought, okay, this is it. Everyone will want to do this. This is 2004 and 2005. Now, when you look at what spectral flow cytometry is, there's two parts to it. There's the collection part, and there's the analysis part. And they're both important, but I will argue that it's the analysis part that is the most critical part. There are many ways of collecting data for spectral, but there's really only one useful way of doing the analysis, and that is taking the spectra and analyzing the spectra in one way or another. And so this was a typical slide that I would show. We had 32 channels, you had one dye, and you had a different dye. This was pretty obvious that there is a difference in there. Even though there were no bandpass filters in our system, no long pass filters in our system, it was easy to separate samples. And if you look at this from a perspective of a relationship between detectors, lasers, and emission wavelengths, this plot sort of gives you the idea of where you can go with spectral. And I compare polychromatic and spectral there, and it's important because in polychromatic we have one detector as one dye, but in spectral we can have n detectors and then we can have n minus one dyes. So when you start thinking that way, I think it opens up some opportunities. And of course, you can use as many detectors as you have or want, and there may be a limit to the number of detectors. We can discuss that. In general terms, the whole idea here is, doesn't matter how many lasers you have opportunities for expanding this. So what did we do? In 2007, Sony Corporation visited our lab, and we demonstrated our very clunky system, which couldn't do real-time analysis, by the way. We collected the data, and then we spent some time analyzing the data because we didn't have the computational power. And Sony saw this as an opportunity, and these are some of the data that we showed Sony. Now, what's interesting about that is that, I've already told you I've given all these talks, and I always thought it was the best thing since sliced bread, but interestingly enough, Sony went off, disappeared, and 2 months before they released their instrument, they turned up to Purdue, and they licensed Purdue's patent. I thought that was rather interesting. And subsequently, Propel licensed the Purdue patent as well. And now, of course, that is Thermo Fisher. So here's a question for all the flow experts. Why was it that none of the conventional cytometry companies adopted spectral cytometry, and it took a new entity, someone had never been in the field of biology, let alone flow cytometry before, to introduce the technology? That doesn't seem to be compatible with the history of our field. I'll ask you, why did BD start Project Newton in 2012 to develop spectral flow cytometry and then shut it down? That's a great question. I guess the bigger point is when BD shut it down, it generated another company, most of whom worked on Project Newton. If you'd like to see the court details of the wonderful case between BD and Cytech, all of the details are on that link. And I encourage you to read it because it's an excellent historical review of how one company tried to develop a technology and then walked away from it for a reason I still don't know to this day, and I hope that I find out before I die. So why did it take so long to get Spectral into the mainstream? These are questions that give me grey, well, it's already white hair, I suppose. Are we stuck in our ideas? Were we so focused as a field of flow cytometry on what we knew that we were trying to thread needles to solve our problems? Is that us? Or was it us? Were the educators not interested in teaching alternative technology? Were we totally stuck in a rut? And I throw that out because as educators, it's critical for us to also teach ideas that may be good or may not be good. Okay, we can't predict always the future. Was there a lack of cross-disciplinary training experiences between flow cytometry and imaging? I grew up in the world of imaging and flow. When I used to run a core lab long time ago, I'm so thankful no longer running, we did imaging and flow, and constantly I had people coming in asking to do flow, and I would say, no, 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 you need to do imaging. People coming in wanting to do imaging, no, it will be much better to do flow. So we had the two together. When you experience other knowledge and other technologies, you have a better grasp on what can or could be done. Were big companies just prepared not to take a risk, or were they complacent? Were they too happy to just keep selling the same technology? Were too many top voices in our field trashing the Spectral idea? Go look at the Purdue discussion list and you'll see some very interesting statements in there. So ask yourselves, why were most of you only focused on polychromatic cytometry, even though you knew it was impossibly difficult when you got to 30 colors and you wanted to get to 32? Very difficult. So now, this is a hypothetical question. Let me just preface that. If a completely new approach to Spectral were to appear, will you be open to it? Or are you going to be stuck with what's Spectral today? Remember this talk one day in the future. So let's think about what might be ahead. Spectral sorting, it's an emerging technology, very important. It's critical. But Spectral flow are all first generation instruments. There is absolutely no difference in the technology in today's Spectral instruments than what that monstrous looking prototype we built 18 years ago. No difference at all. Maybe slightly different detectors, but really no difference. Second generation Spectral instruments will have to have new features. That's a given to me. Fully digital systems will have to appear. Chemometric measurements will be embedded because the technology can handle that. I am so excited about the idea of smart fluorochromes. I'm not going to go into any details, but there are some really clever ideas out there about fluorochromes that I think can change the way we do a lot of our assays today. They're not embedded yet into our systems. And analytical engines are going to be absolutely critical because this is really hard stuff. And I think a new system of system biology is going to emerge. I just think that is a natural progression from where we are today. And I think that the folks who are the core group of flow people are going to have to expand to include a broader science experience, because I think we can't ignore the molecular world. It's got to be more embedded into the flow world. So as technology expands, so too are the demands. We have more parameters to deal with, and you probably already appreciate that software struggles to keep up, particularly software we're using today, because software we're using today is exactly the same as software we used 20 years ago. We haven't really changed. Sure, there's a little bit of change in there, there's a little bit of advanced stuff, but generally we follow the same pathway, don't we? So I can also see that, as some of the talks earlier pointed out, it gets really complicated when you start building these very large protocols. And so we need automation in terms of tools that help us get to that point. And I can see small companies popping up around the world that are addressing those issues, and I'm very excited to see that. And obviously, some offline analysis software is going to be necessary, because I think it could be a headache as we get up to very large parameter numbers. And when I say very large, I'm not talking 40. Larger files means larger computers and higher data complexity. And so the analytical approach has to be changed. I think that's something that I've been thinking about for the last few years. I don't have the solution, but there are people out there who do have that solution. We just have to give them the opportunity to do this. And of course, how do we better integrate the biology with the technology? They are not two separate areas. They are overlapping, but we make them two separate areas. We have to bring them together. And of course, I've pointed out that I think other technology areas will open. Now, we have already seen a huge expansion in Spectral, about a 30% increase in the number of colors just because of Spectral. And that, to me, is a big deal. So the problem is we have this huge analytical problem. So what about other feature spaces? I mentioned spectral sorting before, so I thought I'll just throw in a few slides of some things we're doing in my lab, because we happen to have a spectral sorter, and we're developing some tools in a slightly different area that most of you are probably working in. But as spectral becomes embedded, we as users are going to ask more questions and make more demands. So the manufacturers should be listening very carefully to colloquia like this one. So obviously, if you can separate population analytically, it's a very frustrating thing if you really would like to separate it physically. And so spectral sorting is therefore a critical next requirement for some people. But it's actually computationally demanding, because you know, you've got to do a lot of stuff in a very short period of time. So your electronics has to be custom designed to do this. You won't be able to take a regular sorter and use the electronics in a regular sorter. If you try that, you'll probably fail. I think that one of the advantages is that there is a higher degree of automation. And I can tell you that probably 15 or 18 years ago, I was pretty much banned from touching any of the instruments in my laboratory, particularly the cell sorters, because my technicians claimed unfairly that I would break those instruments because I did things that weren't supposed to be done, or I didn't know the right order to do things. So one of the powerful things that I liked of having Bigfoot in my lab was I could press a button and it aligned it for me and it set the droplet break. It was wonderful. And so I became a cytometrist again, not for very long, because I got kicked out of the lab again for trying to do things that you shouldn't do. But at least I tried, and it allowed me to get into the lab. And I might say I have some technicians that don't have any flow cytometry background that are sorting on that machine every single day. And I think that's a powerful thing. However, it does introduce the problem of a lack of user understanding. And we have to understand what the impact of that is going to be. Because if you don't know what you're doing, and a computer is doing it for you, then all you do is make the mistakes quicker than if you made them on your own. So, big question to everybody here, can we, as cytometry individuals, handle black box technology? And I have changed my perspective on this. Probably 10, 15 years ago, I expected graduate students and postdocs in my lab to make everything up, because then I knew they knew how to make it. And I realized I could go buy a kit from one of the manufacturers that would let them do the assay. And they didn't make any mistakes because the kit really told them how to do it. So I realized it was actually cheaper for me. But the catch is, do people understand? So I think that's something we need to address as a group. How much education do we need when we start having systems that are so clever? So I've always wanted to sort pathogens. I have a lovely set of pathogens in my lab, hundreds of them. But I've never been game to sort them on any sorter, except now we are. So we've been doing all sorts of tests just to make sure that it's working okay and there's no contamination. And I'm glad to say that those tests have been very, very good and shown no contamination. But what we've been doing is sorting onto bacterial plates for some very special reasons, and I'll explain that in the next slide. So here, let me go back. Here is an example of us making some colonies in a very specific place. Don't mind the noise. That, by the way, is the maximum noise Bigfoot makes. It's actually quiet, so I love this. You see how quickly it actually can put down 40, 50, 60 colonies. Well, that's important for us, because what we're interested in doing is looking at relationships between types of organisms and looking at antibiotic resistance and other things that we're working on in our lab. So we've now been working on staining these with various dyes. I haven't put the names of the dyes up there, but we have quite a few different dyes that we've determined, and we're building these spectral tool sets for mixing our organisms in certain ways and analyzing. And we're also building plates with antibiotics in them at different concentrations. And we have a technology that's probably not familiar to any of you, but if you have a colony on a plate and you use a laser, which is almost identical to this laser pointer, and you simply hit the colony just like that. Doesn't damage the colony, doesn't do anything, except what it does is it produces a light scatter, or elastic light scatter, from the laser and onto a camera, and you get a pattern. And it turns out that every organism has a unique pattern. Isn't that fantastic? No reagents. You can tell what the organism is. So if there's a mutation, you can tell. So what we're doing now, we have 160 pathogenic clinical isolates of Salmonella, and we're now developing a database of those. So that's something that we're doing, because it's so easy to create these patterns, which we need perfect single colonies separated from one another. And if you do that any other way, you have a bit of a mess. So this is one thing that we've used. And then combining the spectral, which is a completely separate talk, but I just wanted to give you some idea. And the impact of that is that automation can be transformative, and it lets lower training levels access this technology. It's sterile environment, so it's much better to do this rather than put the instrument in a hood. And I think it became very appropriate in COVID, etc. Dye management, internal database, which is updatable, is important. It's very quiet. I was really shocked at how quiet it was, having been used to these things that turn on and frighten you every now and again. And I think, you know, it'll be expandable. We can even move it across the floor. So I had some ideas I'm going to throw at you. So the future of flow cytometry, and in particular, spectral flow. So if I look at phenotyping, something most of you do every day, we can do cell cycle analysis. We can look at metabolic parameters, and we can look at structural. What is the limitation, do you think, for current flow cytometry? I'm guessing here, I'm saying about 30 phenotype, about two or three cell cycle, maybe a couple more. And metabolic, impossible. Structural, also very difficult. We do more in imaging than we can do in flow, which is amazing to me. But here's what I think will happen in spectral. I think we have an opportunity to really shift this equation in a big way. And I think that when you look at that, this is a significant increase in capability of what the technology can bring. But when you do that, we realize that current flow technology has evolved over the past 50 years. And we call it quantitative. I have no idea how many lectures I've given telling people flow cytometry is a quantitative technology. Isn't that amazing? How many people in this room actually quantitate the number of receptors on their cells on, I'll make it easy, on every experiment that you ever do? I didn't think so. Okay, on some experiments on Thursday afternoons in the east phase of the moon? Okay, one or two. We aren't quantitative at all. We just think we're quantitative because we can count the number of cells. So we have a problem there, folks. It's not quantitative. We need to move it to a quantitative world. And we're very frustrated with this issue of separating noise from signal. It is the bane of our lives. So what does the future hold? Well, I show you this picture because it's very old technology. Jablonski developed the energy diagram in 1933. That's nearly 100 years ago we've known all about this. George Stokes understood the difference between the maximum absorption and the maximum emission wavelengths, the Stokes shift, over 100 years ago. But look at the detail we have here. How much of it do we use? Almost none. We have dimmish, okayish, and brightish. Actually, that's British, isn't it? I didn't think about that. It's almost British. Is that good enough? Is that where you want to be for quantitative science? How satisfied are we with quantification? If you have a cup of tea, since we're in Britain, we have cups of tea, I don't think anyone counts the number of grains of sugar. You just take a teaspoon. Teaspoon of sugar is, yeah, okay. Close enough is good enough, isn't it? But let me give you a bowl or a few bowls of money, of cash. You're just going to say, well, yeah, it's sort of foolish. It's British, brightish. Are you going to select or you want to count the cash? Hold on, this one looks like it's more than that one. I want to go for that one, right? Why don't we do that? This is what we do. This is the life we live in flow cytometry. Sorry to disappoint you. But there is more. So here's a diagram that I think brings Max Planck and Albert Einstein together. And we think of where we are in terms of energy and measurement in flow. And that is where we are, inside that red box. When you measure the number of photons that we have the capacity to measure, we're in that red box. Where can we get to with new generation technologies? Look, we can move a lot. And if we can do that, we have some opportunities. So spectral flow will drive innovation using digital technology with higher sensitivity and more parameters. It will promise more accurate quantification. I think it will better allow comparison of instrument to instrument, which is something we want to do, particularly if you're an organization that has multiple sites. And maybe we could get less errors if we understood the electronics and the noise a little bit better. And you use SI units in your labs, right? Yeah. Do you use SI units in flow cytometry? Oh, of course not. Why would we be quantitative and use actually accepted scientific measurements? It's above 10 degrees and below 40 degrees in the lab. Is that okay? Like warm or really hot? Maybe if we do some of these things, we'll open up opportunities for other fields in molecular biology, biochemistry, and physiology, as I've already indicated. And I think when we invade the world of clinical cytometry, it's desperately in need of quantification properly. So what is the power of machine learning? Last couple of slides. A challenge here for you. Flow cytometry was quite slow to engage the informatics opportunities. We were perfectly happy with a histogram. Well, actually, thousands of histograms. But as high parameter space, okay, we had to address that. And fortunately for us, the informatics world invaded our world, and they helped us along. But what we call AI, which is a really nice general term because it can mean really anything, I think is going to become mission critical in flow cytometry. And I envisage within 3 or 4 years that there will be significantly modified second generation technologies, which I think will have real power, and they'll bring new parameters, more data, and more complexity. So now, this is a picture that was generated by a computer. It is not a photograph. It has no photographic elements. It was generated entirely based on artificial intelligence. I typed in 13 words. Australian bush scene near a sheep station with kangaroos and Sydney Opera House. Well, it got the Opera House, it got the sheep. I still haven't found the kangaroo. If anyone can find the kangaroo. That was done in about, I would say, 2 seconds. 2 seconds. So this time I typed in flow cytometry and fluidics and electronics showing fluorescence with a lymphocyte or neutrophil hematology. And that's what it generated. Looks to me like there's a flow chamber channel there, and there might be something that resembles a lymphocyte and some other stuff. And here, flow cytometry, single cell fluorescence laser. Just 6 words. And what did it do? So now, here we have what artificial intelligence is going to bring to us. We have to engage it. It has to engage us. And we have to be open to that sort of engagement. So why is spectral flow cytometry so critical for flow cytometry? This is the question that I started with. All fields of science ebb and flow. Remember electron microscopy by the 90s? Nobody cared about electron microscopy. And then electronics came, and they wanted nanometer resolution in what happened. Electron microscopy became multi-million dollar technology. Flow cytometry has been inching along for about 50 years, and there really wasn't a whole bunch of innovation. And now it's almost starting again. New companies, new technologies, new approaches, and a whole set of individuals will drive it, I think, for the next few decades. And the clinical world is relatively slow and not at all innovative, which it wants stability, which is fair, but it's going to change with Spectral. But it's going to need quantitative technology, or it isn't going to be successful. So I think from 3 or 4 years from now, there'll be new technologies that rapidly date current instruments. Sorry about that, but when you have a new technology that comes on the field, someone is going to build one better. So we started this a long time ago. I think Spectral opens up new opportunities. The power of being able to use any dye, even dyes that are highly spectrally overlapping, can be discriminated. And I think it has an opportunity to solve things that we have struggled with for many, many years. In terms of data comparison between sites, I think it's a potential there. Now we have cell sorters that can do spectral sorting, and spectral unmixing is entirely automated. And that, to me, is the reason why it's advantageous over compensation. Because in compensation, it's a very subjective thing. It's not subjective when you have a computer tell you what it should be. Is it absolutely correct? Who knows? Is it reproducible? Yes. And maybe reproducibility trumps other alternatives. So I think the next generation of instruments will open up other people, not just those people sitting in this room. The people that you are struggling to get into this room because you can see opportunities for them in flow, but it doesn't quite fit the current paradigm. And I think the downside might be that we're going to become a little bit black box-ish, and we're going to have to learn to live with that, because I think that that is the way of the future. I apologize for taking so long, so much of your time, but I thank you for the opportunity to speak today. Thank you very much.